Now we move to the transient behavior. This is similar to what we have done for PI and R. We will do this kind of analysis for every device that we study. Now we want to understand the transient because we studied the readings, that is the same area. We can understand the power dissipation, the on-state voltage drop. But now, which is the behavior in switching? Because we know that it is very important to have devices that have low power dissipation during the switching and are able to switch quite fast. Similarly to what we have seen and discussed for the PIN diode, also in this case, the dynamic of the BJT is very much dependent on the quasi-saturation region. That is the presence of the large amount of carriers that are stored into the collector region. The analysis is slightly different if we assume a resistive load or an inductive load. Let's now refer to the resistive load for the first case. We are here in the off state, zero current, large voltage on the collector. And here we are in the on state, large voltage, zero current. And here we are in the on state, large current, almost zero voltage. From in the points A and B in this region, here we are in the active region, with no carriers stored into the collector region. And when we move from B to C, we are increasing the amount of charge that is stored into the collector region. The real problem will be moving from C to B and from B to C, because this is the region of the device, the operating region of the device, in which there is a lot of charge that must be stored or removed from the device. The Thurnon in the first case. We are here in the off state, zero current, large voltage. To generate a Thurnon on the device, we assume that a step current that was zero goes to IB3, that is a positive current that goes into the device. The current is large enough to force the device in saturation. We want to reach point C, where the voltage drop on the device is very small, let's say below 1 volt. As soon as we apply the current, the collector current increases rapidly, moving from A to B. And more slowly, moving from B to C, because from B to C we need to provide the carriers to the device to modulate the collector. This shows the behavior of the device during turn-on. This is the emitter, the base, and the collector. In red, we have the carrier concentration into the device. At time T0, there are no carriers into the device because the device is off. When the time increases, initially we have a carrier concentration limited to the base, that goes from T1 to T2. When we arrive at time T2, we begin the quasi-saturation region, and we start to inject T3, T4, and T5. We start to inject carriers into the collector.
From T2 to D5, we extend the base into the collector, filling the entire collector region. The dashed line in the end is the final value that is with the collector completed field. We have a fast transient from T0 to T2 with the collector that increases very fast. The collector current is proportional to the derivative. As you can see here, the collector derivative, the current concentration derivative increases, and the collector current increases. Since we are moving along this line, in the same time, the voltage on the device is decreasing. When we reach T2, point B, here, we have a slower dynamics because the carriers needs to full this region, needs to store a lot of carriers here, and the dynamic is very slow. The VCE reduces slowly, and the same happens for the current. This will increase the turn-on dynamic losses, because in this time period here, VCE is still quite high. We say 10 volts, 12 volts. And the current is almost the maximum. Only at this point, the dynamics losses are quite low because the on-state voltage drop is small and you have almost the maximum current. This effect is more relevant for high voltage BJTs where the collector region is very wide. For the turn-off, we have a behavior similar to that of the PIN diode. We have a lot of charge that is stored into the device, and the only way to switch off the device is to extract these carriers. We have a lot of carriers stored into the base and into the collector. And we start to switch off the device applying a negative current, negative base current. We are extracting current from the device. This is shown here in this plot. We are at time T0 with the base and collector full of charge. At time T0, we start to extract current from the base. IB becomes negative. However, when IB becomes negative, the derivative here is negative and the charge starts to decrease. But note that you don't see any modification of the current and no increase of the voltage until you start depleting this region and you change this current derivative, carrier derivative here. In order to reduce the storage time, you need to increase the negative base that you extract from the negative current that you extract from the base. The storage time is a problem in terms of switching time because the device is slow in its switching, but it's not so bad in terms of power dissipation because during the storage time, the current is high but the voltage is very low. The situation is similar for the more conventional case when we have the inductive switching. This circuit has been studied before. We studied this circuit with an eye on the diode, but this can also be used to study the turn-off and turn-on behavior of a bipolar junction transistor or of a MOSFET. Let's see the turn-on. Before the transient, the BJT is in the off condition. IC is equal zero, and the entire inductor current flows through the diode. The diode has a very low voltage drop, let's say 1 volt, and the VCC, the voltage on the collector, is VCC plus 1 volt. When the turn on, when the device is turned on, its collector current increases linearly, but the diode is still on. The only way to see a reduction of the collector voltage is bringing in the diode in reverse conduction. This means that the current will increase up to IL, even more if we take into account the reverse recovery current of the diode, and only then the collector voltage will decrease. Similarly for the turn off, we have the maximum current here, the voltage is very low, we switch off the device, the voltage starts to increase, but the current is still at its maximum. Only when this voltage overcomes VCC and is able to switch on the diode, the device current can decrease. The difference in the behavior is what we have seen more than once, is this one. For the resistive load, we have turn on and turn off any a decrease of the voltage with an increase of the current, while for the inductive load, the current increases during the turn on with the maximum voltage, and only after the current is at its maximum, the voltage decreases, and the same for the turn off. Again, for this device, the inductive switching is provides increased power dissipation if compared to a resistive switching. In this plot that we see, in the plot that we see here, we are not including the parasitic effects that are unfortunately present in these devices. First of all, the diode is ideal. Second thing, we don't have parasitic inductances. If we take into account the parasitic effects, the operating point of the switching in the IC-VC plane are different. For the resistive switching, this locus would be this line. We will move from this point to this point. For the inductive switching, it should be this square waveform that is dashed black in this plot. However, there are differences. For the turn-on, for example, the current increases with the maximum voltage. But arriving, once I'm arriving to the load current, I also have to add the reverse recovery current of the diode. And hence I have this kind of switching like this. When we turn on off the device, this effect is usually given by the parasitic stray inductance that are present in the layout of the device. The overshoot that we see in this case causes an overshoot of the voltage that it goes above the maximum VCC. This is very important because if, for example, we are driving a circuit with 300 volts of supply voltage, maybe that due to the stray inductances, you can reach up to 350, 400 volts on the device. This means that you need to introduce a due safe margin for the choice of the breakdown voltage of your device. This effect can also be shown with a simulation. This is the inductive load switch circuit. These are the test conditions, bus voltage and load current. Here we have the inductor, not a current generator. This means that the first thing that we have to do is switching on this device in order to charge this inductor. This is the on time that is proportional to IL V bus, and it is 1 millisecond in this case. There are some parameters in this simulation. There is a test device that is an ideal device with a given, with just a small resistance in series. And we have the on time that is 1 millisecond and the rise and fall times of the switching that are 0.2 microsecond. There is a transient simulation though. Let's run the transient simulation. This is the inductive load switch circuit. Let's see if I saved. Something. No, this is the switching. Okay. This is the power dissipation on the device. This is VC multiplied current. While this is these are the currents and the voltages. The device that we choose is not a BJT, this is a MOSFET, but this is just to show the effect of the inductance and the parasitic inductance and the reverse recovery of the diode. In this case, we don't have parasitic inductances and we don't have the reverse recovery. If I analyze this is the turn off. The current goes to zero and the voltage goes to the maximum. You can see that before the current starts to decrease, we need to bring the voltage to the maximum. The same happens for the turn on. Here the current goes to the maximum before the voltage starts to decrease. And we have this peak of power dissipation. We can also view the locus in the IV plane. In this case, we have the voltage here, and here we have the current. As you can see, this the behavior of the device moving from the off state to the on state and vice versa follows the theory. We firstly move vertically, and then we move horizontally. This is the theory without the parasitic effects. If we now see what happens with the introduction of the reverse recovery. In this case, we use a fast recovery diode, the one with the improved model. More or less the same. Let's run the simulation. What you can see is that during the turn on, you don't see much. Here you see the peak of the current. Excuse me. This is the turn off of the device. And here you can see that you have just a peak over voltage, small over voltage here. The current goes from the maximum to zero. The behavior is similar to the theory that we studied. Here you see something different. During the turn on of the device, the current increases. Reaches the 20 amps that are the load current, but the current still increases even more, continues to increase. Why this situation? Because the diode is now turning off, and when the diode turns off, there is the reverse recovery, and there is a negative current through the diode. This negative current through the diode is an additional current into the device.
This is the collector current of the device. This is the diode current. This is IL. And you have that IC is equal to IL minus ID. If the ID is negative, the current in the device is larger than the 20 amps that flow here.
In the IV plane, this can be seen in this way. This is the small overvoltage during turn on, but this is the turn on of the device. So you can see the current does not stop at 20 amps, but goes to very high value, that is 27, this is a fast recovery diode, and then it goes to zero. If we also include the presence of the parasitic inductance that we introduced here and run the same simulation, we also see an effect during the turn off of the device. Here. This is a parametric analysis. There is more than one value for the parasitic inductance. As you can see, the voltage does not stop to 200 volts, but there is an increase in this case up to 240.
Why this overvoltage? Why this overvoltage? You can put the parasitic inductance more or less wherever you want. In this case, we put the parasitic inductance on the collector of the device. Now,
we are turning off the device.
The device is on and we are turning it off. There is a large current going here. This current is IL. It is more or less 20 amps. When I turn off the device,
the first thing that happens is that the voltage increases.
With the current remaining more or less constant. The voltage increases. At a certain point, the diode starts to conduct, and there is some current flowing here. In this inductor, there is a current flowing in this direction. In order to reduce the current in this in the parasitic inductance, because I want to bring this current to zero, the only way is applying a voltage in this direction. In this direction. This means that in the end, the voltage we see, this is the collector region, VC will be equal to V bus. Plus VD, that is the voltage drop on the diode, plus VL. VL is positive, as you can see, and this will increase the collector voltage drop. Collector of the voltage.
If the parasitic inductance is very large, those values are 20 microhenry, 30 microhenry, let's say from tens to hundreds of microhenry, but this is enough to provide overvoltages of 10 volts, 50 volts, even 100 volts. If I plot this switch in the IV plane, we see the behavior in this last case. This is the turn on of the device from this point to this point, and this is the effect of the reverse recovery. The current does not stop to 20 amps but goes up to 30 amps. And these peaks are the effect of the parasitic inductance. The voltage on the device does not stop to 200 volts, but there is an overvoltage, overshoot, that as a function of the parasitic inductance, in this case, reaches 240 volts. The last thing that I want to show you before concluding is if I come back to the final, to the previous analysis, the peak power dissipation here is 4.2 kilowatts, and here it is 6 kilowatts. 6 and 5, 4.2. If I see, watch what happens in the conventional case, the values are 3.6 and 3. You can see that the parasitic inductance and the reverse recovery are increasing the power dissipation in the switching, are largely increasing these values. We can also run a similar simulation with the resistive load. In this case, the behavior is what we saw in the analysis. While the voltage decreases, the current increases, and the peak power dissipation is less than 1 kilowatt. We say 25% of the inductive switching. That was 4 kilowatts, now we have 1 kilowatt. These are the difference. And as you can see, the switching power can increase from 1 to 6 kilowatts. There is a large difference between resistive inductive and inductive including parasitics.